Hey, Lady Vol Nation, this is Akilah Laster, Media Relations Director for Tennessee Softball and Football. As Tennessee Athletics continues to celebrate Black History Month, I'm very honored today to be joined by two Lady Vol softball alum. First, India Childs, who we are honoring in this segment, and next, Tianna Batts, who followed in India's footsteps. Well, welcome and thank you for joining us today, India and Tianna. How are you all today?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing well and happy Black History Month.
Thank you. Happy Black History Month. Same to you.
Thanks. So, India, you are the person of the hour and of the decade and the legend of Lady Vol softball. You are the first Black All-American for Tennessee softball. You were an academic All-American. You have multiple All-District honors. You were the SEC Player of the Year in 2007, a College World Series tournament team member, first team All-SEC, so many accolades. When you hear those distinguished honors, what does that make you reflect on? Talk about your time at Tennessee when you're looking back on all that.
You know, Tennessee was a huge blessing. But Tennessee was a grind, you know. I appreciate everything about my days. I appreciate being pushed to the limits. And honestly, from the teammates that I had when I was at Tennessee, that was the standard that we were all pushing for. So I was just one of the lucky and blessed ones that actually achieved it.
And talk about the culture that was set by you and your teammates at that time for the program.
A lot of zero tolerance. I still use this today, but the weeklies really stressed, you know, leaving our baggage at the gate every single day and using softball as a release, right? As a time to just let all the stressors go and just play free and take chances. And that was really the culture that we had. We believed we were champions. There were champions all around us on UT's campus, from football to Lady Vol basketball to soccer and everyone in between. It was a championship atmosphere, and we didn't want to be left out of that. So we were pushing just as hard as our other friends on campus and athletics.
Awesome. And Tianna, bringing you into this, did you follow India growing up? And I know you guys got to work together once you got here as she was the volunteer assistant coach. What was it like growing up watching India and then being coached by a Lady Vol legend?
Growing up, honestly, I was a basketball fan, and I love Pat Summitt. I looked to her players, and I wanted to play college sports, but I knew I was probably a little too small to play basketball, so I got into softball, and when it became softball, I was still a Tennessee fan, still bled orange, but I was like, who can I look at now that, you know, looks like me, plays like me? So seeing India was like really truly inspiring. And the day she came out, I remember Ralph was like, we don't know who's gonna be our coach. Like, he was just tossing names, and he said India Childs, and I literally was like starstruck. So the day she came out to practice, though, like, my nervousness had went down because she was so personable, and just like from that day was like, I felt like I had known her my whole life, like almost like a little auntie vibe. But she was very there, and like, she carried everybody and was there for us day one. Like, first day at practice, I felt like she was there for all of us, infielders, outfielders, like she was there to give her all and inspire us, just not based off of how she performed, but then in that day, it wasn't about India, it was what India gave to us.
India, hearing that kind of sentiment and you know, recollection of Tianna's time and her growing up seeing you, did you know at the time that you were blazing the trail or that you would have that impact on not only Black girls, but just the softball sport in general?
I had no idea. It's just kind of like when you're in it, you're in it, right? And I wasn't thinking about being the first. I remember when I won SEC Player of the Year and sitting at the banquet for SEC, and nothing in me made me believe that that award was going to come to me. Not only because I was a slap hitter, but quite honestly, because of the color of my skin. I didn't think I had a shot. I didn't worry about it. It wasn't a stressor. It wasn't a chip on my shoulder. I was there to cheer on whoever's name was announced. And when I was in it, I was just playing and grinding. And a lot of that has to do with my upbringing. I have six siblings, four of which played at a very high level all the way up through college for basketball. And that was just the culture of my family, right? If we were involved in something, we went 150% and we didn't quit. And I was just giving my all for Tennessee and doing what I was told, right, from my coaches, and fighting for playing time and fighting for championships. So when I was in it, I wasn't thinking at all of being a trailblazer. And it wasn't until many years after that I realized that there were so many firsts behind my name. But I think that's kind of the beauty of it, right? Just kind of show up, do your job, and good things will come to you.
When your name was called as the SEC Player of the Year, what did that feel like?
Well, my stomach dropped, and it just felt like a huge release. Like I said, playing at UT was hard, just because they pushed us so much, right? If you could imagine playing for someone from the military and who had coached men's football, and playing for someone who was an attorney, there's not a lot of slack that can take place there. And my parents were tough, but I had never been coached to that capacity. I had never been told, you know, to correct so much on the softball field and pay so much attention to detail. And, you know, that tests my pride, it tests my ego. But when my name was announced, it was like the glory of, you know, it was all worth it. And it was all being recognized finally. And it was just an awesome feeling.
And Tianna, can you relate to India's experience as far as the intensity of what it was like to be a Lady Ball softball player? I mean, you're a recent alum. So what was that experience like for you as well?
It was very, very intense. Like she said, playing for someone that in the military, like there's a standard. And my high school coach was a Marine, so I knew the standard coming in with Ralph. So I knew it was, you know, I was coming to play softball, but I was also coming to be a part of a service of some type. So it was very team and, you know, no excuses. And they're just looking for results, really. And when you play in a program like that, you just have to bring it every day. Like India said, leaving your baggage at the door is really big on a program like that. Like you can't come in and be thinking about problems. You really got to come in and go to work for not just you, your other teammates to the left or right of you, because they're going through the same things. So it was pretty intense.
Now you both had Black teammates, correct? Well, Tianna, I know you did. India, correct? What was that like? Because we're going to get into some of the, you know, the diversity or lack thereof in softball, but what was that like playing with somebody that looked like you, maybe for the first time, or, you know, one of very few times?
It was a dream, quite honestly. And for the first time, you know, I had grown up and I may have had one Black teammate, maybe on my team, maybe one I'm playing against. And it doesn't matter what you look like. When people look like you, you pay attention to that. You may not communicate it and address it, but you pay attention to that, right? And when I was at UT, there were several that looked like me, 5, 6, 7 that looked like me. And there were more that didn't look like me, but that fell under minorities. And it really felt like a homecoming of sorts. We called each other sister on and off the field. We hung out on and off the field. We kind of were able to relate and talk about our families on and off the field. And it's something that the older I get, the more and more and more I appreciate that and understand how fortunate I was. Because even today, and being a mentor to younger girls coming through, you know, the high school, and even some that are currently in college, and even some that graduated out, and also our recruits, you know, it is rare that we don't have an African-American recruit come to UT who doesn't reach out to me, her and her parents, and just ask what the experience is like. And, you know, usually will I be accessible? And they were my sisters, and they still are my sisters. And everyone isn't that fortunate to play with people who look like them, of a minority race. And I don't even know that I could completely grasp what that felt like and what that feels like and how important that is. But they're family, they're still family, whether they stayed at UT or didn't. Every single one of them are still family.
Tianna, would you like to add something to that?
Yeah, I totally agree with India. It's almost like a shell shock because you go really your whole life, you know, from T-ball to travel ball, and you have, like she said, one or two people. Well, I typically didn't have anybody. So when I got to Tennessee, I think that was my biggest excitement to look for. You know, most people's like my first game or, you know, first practice, but to be on a team of a roster of at least five or more Black girls was very eye-opening, and it was amazing, honestly. Like, I had great relationships with them. I still have great relationships with them until this day. Like, I leaned on them on my roughest days because I see people that look like me, especially in college, being away from home. You know, we don't FaceTime is all you can do, but to have those teammates that you can call and just go over and explain, and they actually know where you're coming from, is a big deal. It helps more on the field than off the field that they're there.
So I have some data from the NCAA from 2012 to 2019, the percentage of Black females who made a Division I softball over throughout the country was between 7 to 8%. Based off your experience, it doesn't sound like that's surprising, but do you guys have any insight to why you think that is, and also what that kind of says about the sport?
Yeah, I have a couple things. One is kind of going back to the principle of being around people who look like you. And I can recall playing rec sports at it, like, you know, I think I played in up through the age of 12 or maybe 14. I can't remember. But when I was the younger I was, the more, you know, Black kids participated in softball, from T-ball to machine pitch. And then it seemed more and more would migrate out to basketball and football. And without saying anything, you know, those kids and just wanted to play around people that look like them. There were more Black kids playing football and more Black kids playing basketball than playing baseball and softball. It was not a skill issue at all. In fact, a lot of them were really, really good, and they just left the sport young to go play where they felt like they belonged more. The other thing is, you know, it's a problem in youth sports, in every youth sport, but it's becoming such a business and a moneymaker. And travel ball, for one, is very, very expensive. So the price to play the sport at a competitive level has increased so much that that holds a lot of Black girls out of the sport. Because if someone's not going to pay thousands of dollars for you to play for one summer or one fall, then you can't participate at that level. And that's where the college coaches are going out to recruit, is at those tournaments where it costs, you know, $1,500 to even participate. So those are kind of two highlights that I would point out. And, you know, one is a huge issue in every sport that a lot of people are trying to address. But, you know, when people don't look like you, you don't always feel so warm and welcomed.
And what do you think needs to be done to kind of rectify these issues?
You know, I think if we would just pay attention to what youth sports are for, and representation and diversity and inclusion, at the highest level, being collegiate athletics, I don't think the NCAA does enough to stress how important diversity and inclusion training is for coaches. Because, you know, of all sports, you need to understand these kids' backgrounds. For my brothers, there was one in particular, there wasn't a week I came home that there wasn't a college basketball coach sitting on the couch talking to my parents in our home, trying to understand what our family stood for and what would work. In softball, you know, you show up at a tournament, you see a kid swing or throw, and then you offer them the world. Come play for me. And you really lose that personal touch. But I think that if coaches would pay more attention to being culturally aware, socially aware, and paying attention to the importance of representation on their staff, as well as diversity, that would help. right? There need to be more Black coaches in every sport, but for sure softball. And then we need to stop trafficking of sorts. That's a strong word, but you know, it seems in travel ball, it's just grow. How many teams can you have under one name, right? Can you get to 100 teams? Can you get to 500 teams? And that becomes just a moneymaker, right? You want the kids to come and play for you. And at the highest level, you're just pulling in funds and not really paying attention to what that kid is asking for, which is talent and to be developed. But if we would lower the cost and get back to the real reason for youth sports, I know that we would see more and higher numbers in participation.
And now both of you are now private coaches. I know you all work together. Tianna, you took Tianna under your wing. Talk about that and your mission as coaches. And India, you also mentioned that you have a travel ball team to kind of help push that that change that you guys are hoping to see.
Yeah, so I'm the director over a new travel ball organization. So we just launched in the fall. A big initiative behind that was to be a resource for these kids and recruiting at a time when coaches can't come out. Another huge initiative we had, because I actually have a co-director, was to embrace diversity in every which way and every form. I have, of the seven teams, I think I have five coaches that are Black. And with that came the kids wanting to play for our team. And it's very important to embrace it, but also, you know, you could never explain to me how you have such a highly saturated market of, I'll just say Black, you know, of Black participation, right? If this was an industry, you have, there's no other industry that has as much participation from Black people as sports in the United States. And going to the highest level of that, if you think of going up the chain, the representation from the coaching end is extremely poor. So we excelled at the game and we're coaching the game because we understand the game. And that is something that is rare for any of the kids to see of any color. So I just want to be that avenue and outlet because right now it's like, you know, you can play the game, but you can't coach the game. That's kind of the message that's being put out. And I don't believe that. There's a lot that can play the game and know the game and need to be given the opportunity to coach at a high level.
And Tianna, what can you add to that? I mean, you just got done playing and now you're on the other side of it coaching. What kind of messages and interactions are you having with your players that can help facilitate some of these things that India is talking about and that you've learned from her and from your own experience?
Yeah, I've taken on a lot from India, not just softball, but like more off the field and now in my life as growing up as an adult, and she's been my mentor through it all, and it's helped me go to work. And I have some players that come to me for training, and I have some players that come to me because I look like them. That's what they need to see. So I try to give back the same persona and what India has been off to me and other Black girls that played college softball and reached the dreams that we have because of her. So I try to instill that in my girls, and I have conversations with them on the daily, typically the Black ones, asking them like, are you the only one? Because usually they know they're the only one, but they're thinking, do you know I'm the only one? Was she the only one? Like, they're trying to gain a relationship with me. And I just try to motivate them like, hey, I don't know if you will ever have a Black coach or Black teammates, but you can do it and you can get through it alone, but you can definitely get through it if you do have those teammates. And don't quit. Don't let anyone tell you no, don't stop, and don't leave this sport because you feel like you aren't in or you feel like you're the oddball out. Like, it's more to that, and you can lead an example the way I'm leading. Like, I always tell my high school girls, you're going to be me in 4 years and it's going to go by quick. So figure that you're grasping it, even the adversity. That way you can teach someone else how to get through on the bad days.
And that's a good way to kind of close it out. India, Tianna, one, thank you. And India, I'll let you close. What was your overall message to little Black girls and then to the overall softball community trying to inspire them, talk about Black history and what it means to for you to be you and a Lady Vol?
My strongest advice is just based off of fight or flight principle. You know, when things get hard, you have to fight. Don't give up, don't quit, don't run away. The answer is to fight through it. Our ancestors did it. I made it, Tianna made it. If we can do it, you can do it. And life isn't easy for anyone, but maybe you have, you know, we have different barriers in place, but we have to fight through and use everything, every chip on the shoulder as fuel and ammo to keep pushing harder. Because just as, you know, we blazed the trail, someone did it before us, and that that flame can't die, right? It is our job to continue to be a resource, but for the younger kids, you know, I want someone to be the new trailblazer and be doing this interview years later. So my strongest advice is just keep fighting. Just keep fighting. Don't flight.
I love that. Thank you so much. Thank you, India. Thank you, Tianna. This was amazing.